happening? Ron?
Oh, thank you, Ron. Good morning, Oshkosh. How are we doing this morning? Oh, man, you can do better than that. Look at this. Look at this ramp. Look at this plane. Look at these skies. How are you doing this morning? All right. All right. So how many first year to AirVenture rookies? Outstanding. And the rest of you are all grizzled veterans. Thanks for coming back. My name is Chip Berger. I'm the voice of the Warbirds Living History Group. This is a subset of us, cast of characters. Please come by and see us. Look for the olive drab tentage over there beyond yonder, or just follow your nose for the faded, musty canvas cell. We have displays of Army Air Forces, Navy, glider infantry, Royal Canadian Air Force, Spitfire pilots, all sorts of amateur historians like myself and this lady and gentleman back here would be delighted to talk your ear off about any of the artifacts, equipment, the gear, uniforms, etc. So we've got quite the treat. We've got a lot of planes. We've got a lot of crew. So I'm going to get into this without much further ado. Within the Warbirds Living History Group, as living historians, we try to put the human face on what the folks who flew these planes, who flew and fought war. It's fascinating because you see how fast the technology advanced through the war for all the branches of aviation throughout the world, more so than any other branches of service. So without much ado, we're going to start off with our first Navy pilot. Please come forward. So Ensign Van Lin here is wearing a basic khaki service uniform. You see that a lot in the Pacific. Some wore the flight suit, some because of the temperature and the climate, just easier to fly around in just a regular khaki officer's uniform, which looks a lot like the enlisted khaki uniforms of the U.S. Army, because most of the times they were. He is wearing on his hat the early style canvas flight helmet. You can see where a bit of improvisation was done, where to add receivers for his electronics, for his communications needs. Leather cups were sewn on here, and sewn into these leather cups are the receivers that he uses to communicate with the fleet, with the rest of his flight, etc. And a plug here that would plug into extension cord that would plug into the socket set within his fighter plane. Over everything else here, he is wearing a seat back chute. So often when you think of parachutes, you think of paratroopers, right? And they have the big back suit, or they have a chest pack or a reserve chute here. This kind of parachute you sit on during the flight. It is your seat cushion. And if you look in the cockpit of the aircraft, there's no cushion there. There's no seat. It's just kind of a metal shell hollowed out that you sit in. And all these sit here and with these recesses. So this is the parachute contained in here. It is held by good old-fashioned bungee cords. And when he turn around here this way, when he pulls on the D handle on this side here, that pulls a cable through this conduit, opens up a couple of safeties, the bungee spring, out comes the parachute. And these here, which are all strapped down and snapped down, pop up and become his risers, just in case he has to hit the silk. He is wearing underneath that the early war Mark I type life vest. The May West can be inflated by CO2 cartridges here and here. You pull on those just like the safety briefing you get on the airliner. You know, don't pull on the tabs until you get outside of the aircraft. Same rules apply here. And just like those ones that you're told are under your seat on the airliner, in case these fail on you, you've got inflation tubes right there where you can get old human huff and puff, etc. He's wearing the rough out boondocker style shoes. So he's most likely operating from a fixed base, an island someplace in the Pacific, as opposed to operating off of a carrier like us brown shoe jobs here. And on top of the helmet here, this is a private purchase set of, you see a lot of this early in the war, private purchase set of goggles with the tinted lenses to cut down on the glare that you have in the Pacific. Fantastic, and some gloves to protect his hands while flying. Next. We have some deck crew, and we see the colored shirts. Gentlemen, could you step forward? Both of you, please. Now, he's portraying an ensign pilot in World War II right now, but in actuality, Shane Van Lin is a petty officer, second class in surface warfare, damage control specialist, and served on the Kitty Hawk, which was a carrier. And if you notice the movies like Top Gun or the most recent Top Gun, you see the deck crew running around with different colored shirts and helmets and stuff like that. All that has roots in carrier aviation in World War II and earlier. And all those colors means all those folks on the deck, each one is a specialist with a particular specialty. And here to talk us through all of those is Shane Van Lin.
Thank you, Chip. So, yes, the term is Skittos, but that came in around 1970s, I believe it was. But there is a variety of the Skittos. We have two here, one in the blue and one in the green. The blue is the ABH, or the plane handler. And then you also had the green, which was the arresting gear. There was also red with a black stripe. That was ordnance men. Red was just solid damage control or firefighting. Then you had brown, which was the plane captain. And modern day has the purple, or we call those the grapes, which are the fuelers. And you can see it on the flight deck. It's all choreographed, and everybody knew or should have known what their part was during the operation of every launch of aircraft. Pretty much they're wearing the dungaree pants with black or rough-out, typically black boots. And they would wear the jerseys here, one for help identify more, but it also it's a more thicker canvas, so they could get into firefighting if they had to. They also have we have one wearing the watch cap with goggles, because up on the flight deck you have prop wash, and you got the sea spray and everything else like that. We also have a canvas flight deck helmet, one that was their protection at the time, along with goggles. And also, again, to help identify each individual. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. If you could please step back in the semicircle. And next, I'd like to let this young lady introduce herself and describe her uniform, because it's got a unique story. Andrea, would you please step forward?
Hi, my name is Andrea, and today I'm representing the U.S. Navy WAVES. WAVES is an acronym for Women Accepted for Voluntary Emergency Service. And in about late July of 1942, females were allowed into the Navy, and they were to learn and take jobs stateside, home front areas, so that men would be freed up to go to the front lines. And that's a call that my grandmother answered in 1943. She was in the service until 45. She was an aviation machinist, and she studied at the Great Lakes Naval Academy. Her background was in jewelry repair, so she worked on all the pieces and parts inside of a cockpit, radios, etc. They also had jobs, air traffic controller, there's postal workers, paperwork, parachute folding, basically anything that was stateside they were learning so that everybody could go somewhere else. I'm wearing the summer working uniform. It is cotton. It is lightweight. It has a fancy pocket up here for my watch so I know when my lunchtime is. It is seersucker gray, and my hat is, I'm enlisted, I'm not an officer, so this is a bucket hat, and the crowns are interchangeable. So there was a seersucker one, a dark blue one to go with the blues, and the white one was interchangeable with this uniform and also the summer whites, which is a little more dressy. I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. I love the little family touch whenever we can do that, so I want to make sure we brought that forward. Plus, we always have a bunch of guys out here on the ramp, right? So I'd like to give the women on our camp equal chance, because usually, you know, if we have a WASPs warbird in review, we can be able to get them involved. So any kind of time we can do that, we try to do that. So thank you very much. All right, let's get back to pilots here. And I think what I'm going to do is have both you gentlemen step forward so we can do a compare and contrast of these two naval pilots. So again, we're just going to kind of start at the top and work our way down. We'll just have to start earlier with him. So he is wearing the same canvas helmet that you saw Ensign Van Lin wearing, with that, with the, you know, the improvised leather ear cups sewn onto there to have the receivers that talk to the electronics and radio system on his plane, allow him to communicate with the rest of the flight and with the carrier deck on takeoff and landing. On top of his helmet, he's wearing the Mark I goggles. And if you compare the size of this, which were identical to the Army issue ones and the Army Navy issued ones here, you can see how much broader the glasses are. If you haven't picked up already, the Navy very much did their own thing when it came to design of all their equipment. It was very different from that of the Army Air Corps. It's only later in the war you start to see a convergence of like, well, we can use some of the same things for the same purposes and like. So definitely strictly Navy here. Captain Blecky here is going to be flying at altitude, so he's equipped with an oxygen mask. And also at his neck, you can see is a throat mic. And the reason you need that is when you have an oxygen mask over your face, nobody can hear what you're talking. In Hollywood, they always have, you know, they pick up a little handheld thing and talk like it's on a CB radio in a truck. But that doesn't work if you're on oxygen, you're flying at higher altitudes. So this is what is called a throat mic. These were made by a number of U.S. companies, including Western Electric. The folks in the suburbs of Chicago made your telephone sets, well, your grandfather's telephone sets, and Shure. And if you're into recorded music or broadcast music and like, you know what a Shure microphone is. Who are my electric guitarists in the crowd? Any electric guitarists in the crowd? Wow, none. We usually have like three. So anyway, like your Fender Stratocaster or your Gibson Les Paul, these are pickups. And they pick up on the vibrations within the vocal box and plug those in to his radio system. He's wearing the early war Mark I vest. And once you turn here, different parachute design, right? The earliest one we saw here was all fixed together. There was a fixed seat chute back in here. Other ones had other equipment there. We'll get to that in a little bit. But you notice we got the back pad, like he's got it. But anybody notice something missing down here? Yeah, there's no parachute. And that's because they figured out it's better to have it in the plane, right? It's something that the plane captain, the folks can handle, et cetera. And for moving around on deck, scrambling around on a pitching carrier, trying to get to your plane, very, very busy, need to get to your plane, get in there, get off in a hurry, you can get a lot there on deck a lot easier with just having this quick attach system, and that's what it's called, the quick attach system, than this bouncing up and down in your derriere as you're trying to get into one of these planes. And oh, by the way, there's whirling propellers going around, et cetera. So just, again, an advancement in design. Let's keep the parachute and anything that goes with the parachute, like a life raft or anything like that, in the plane, hop in. Crew chief, plane captain, helps them get all connected in, get strapped in, test everything off, get ready to go and go off the end of the carrier. And see what else he's wearing. Again, the khaki uniform. And again, we're wearing the brown shoes. So again, he's operating off of a carrier, you know, the brown shoe aviation part of the U.S. Navy at that time. All right. So we're going to go into the future here chronologically. And we're going to have Lieutenant, senior grade, Zaharias. In his gear, so he's wearing a much more modern type aircraft. It's still canvas because we're still flying in warmer climes in the Pacific. But you can see they put in nice, big, round, rubberized donuts here in order to put the receivers in. And inside here, there's lots of cushioning and padding, which does two things. One, it makes it a lot more comfortable for all that to fit on your head. It also eliminates all the noise from around you, so you can get a better auditory response from the receivers in your head. It's nice, comfortable, packed up against your ears. You can hear better, etc., rather than the improvised design that you see from the before. He's wearing the later AN-6530 goggles. And if you look at all these goggles, they have these little things on top of those. That's not decoration. These are little ports to allow air in. So as you go up and down and you change in temperature and humidity, you don't get a total fog job within your goggles. Once you turn around, and you see things a lot more busy back here. Again, a CPAC design. He sits on this. This sits in a metal tray in the cockpit. Your parachute. On top of this is a padding here. He's got the back pad for comfort. On a lot of these parachute systems, especially the ones used by the Navy, the seat pad was actually an inflatable light vest. So it was in a protective covering like that. But if you ditched as opposed to parachuting out of the plane, you now have a life raft with supplies and things like that to survive while pitching up and down in the waters of the Pacific. Lieutenant Zaharias is wearing the Navy 422 jacket. A lot of people call that the G1. That's the current parlance of it. Again, what you see the naval aviators wear in the movies like Top Gun and the most recent Maverick one. So this is the Navy's version of the A2. It's the thick leather protect you from the elements type flying jacket. This is the later version of Life Vest, May West. And I mentioned the word May West earlier when I was talking about Infantryman Lynn. For you younger crowd, if you don't know who May West was and why these are called May West, ask your grandfather, and after he stops giggling, he might explain to you why exactly that is. The rest of you folks kind of clue them in on this. But you can see the earlier ones were much more like a waistcoat type. The wraparound, they found that was kind of cumbersome in the cockpit, and it really didn't do anything from a functionality standpoint. So they took a nod from the Army Air Force's designs, and they started making common designs for these life vests, these May West. So this is much more of a horse collar type. These earlier ones, some of them were just canvas with bladders inside of them. This one is a heavy, sturdy, ruggedized, Goodyear solid rubberized surface protected from the elements. Include its flotation, make sure that salt water doesn't affect it negatively. Same kind of principle, inflated by CO2 cartridges down here and inflation tubes like that. But just an easier fit in the cockpit rather than having this bulky thing wrapped around you. For his protection, in case he lands around hostiles, he's got his service pistol, the M1911, or in the World War II variant, the M1911A1 45 caliber semi-auto pistol. You see these issued to flyers later in the war. Ensign Lynn has got one here. Earlier in the war, the flyers were issued the U.S. version of the Victory revolver, which is the Smith & Wesson Model 10 38 Special for the U.S. The export versions of those were in 38 caliber British. And this is an example of one of those and the type of shoulder holster that they would wear. So early on in the Pacific, you see more of these with the pilots. And again, like anything else, later on, they tend to standardize more on the 1911 45 caliber. And you can see the, since this has to be loaded like a revolver, the extra rounds of ammunition are tapped in up here in these little pockets. And like I said before, this lieutenant is operating off of some forward base that's been captured, now turned into a strip. So he could be at, Henderson or at Guam or Guam or Robo or something like that that's been taken back from the Japanese. And he's wearing a summer weight flight suit over his uniform. And again, that was just kind of a choice of the pilots in terms of what they wore based on the missions that they were flying, the climate, where they were in the Pacific, et cetera. All right. I think we've covered all of that. How about a hand for these guys? Thank you. Thank you. Very kind. By the way, I know this is an old joke as I use every day. We consider this part of the act, the sweating to the oldies. And we say Richard Simmons stole that from us. But you put on the layers here in the nice, beautiful, warm Wisconsin sun. It gets a little warm and the like. We have a little time for some Q&A. Yes, we do. We have some time for some Q&A. Are there any questions from the stands? Raise your hands, please. Wow. I say, there's no way I'm that good, so there's got to be some questions out there. Hey, good morning.
I was curious about the throat microphone. What did those sound like? And does anybody still have any of them that are still operating?
Okay, very good question. Let me try to capture all that. He was interested in the throat mic. That the aviator second from the right is wearing there, what they sound like and are any still in operation, they're out there. There were multiple models that were made. That's the Navy version. There was a different one, different model. Again, you're picking up on the theme. Navy had something different for everything, right, by design. Usually because of specifications, operating out of carriers different than operating out of a forward base or flying a B-17. The Air Force had their own designations. They were made by some of the same companies. As far as what they sound like, a lot of it is not the function of the microphone so much as a function of what is plugged into. So these old tube-type sets and the like, it's just, it's a combination of the entire system. A couple years ago, they had a couple P-40s parked side by side, and they had the original vintage radios in them and hooked it up so they could talk plane to plane and hear what it sounded like. And the way I could describe it is scratchy. But then again, these are, you know, 50-60-year-old radio sets. When they were brand new, maintained by a radio specialist or a team of specialists on the carrier, they were probably much more crisp in the communications. But are they, they're still in operation? I mean, they still work. You just have to have something to plug it into. All right. I am getting the hook signal here, so we have to wrap this thing up. Give yourself a great hand for being a great audience. Appreciate the attention. Appreciate all you coming out here. Great full bleacher set of crowd. And again, please come see us over in camp, especially if you want to come by on Thursday night. There is a USO show, and I guarantee, if it's like most years, it will be a hoot. All right, everybody, enjoy the day. Enjoy the rest of the week. Come see us, and we'll see you. We'll be back here again tomorrow morning. Chipper for Warbirds Living History Group signing off. Enjoy.
Thank you, gentlemen and ladies, this morning. The reenactors folks, as Chip said, make sure to go down and visit them. You'll see their camp to your left, down there with the green canvas tents. They'd be happy to show you all their gear and to talk about it. And a good Wednesday morning, and welcome to Warbirds in Review. In just a few moments, we'll be starting our program talking about these beautiful cats that you see in front of you. So, folks, if you're in the Warbirds area, make your way over here to our bleachers, and we'll start the program here in just a few minutes. But before we do, we have some entertainment for you from a lady that's been with us for the last 10 years. If you would, please give a warm welcome to Miss Teresa Eamon.
Good morning. Sorry, I have to take care of my Crown Royal bag for a second. There we go. I could buy an expensive mic cover, but why bother when a Crown Royal bag works just as well? How are you all this morning? Happy Wednesday. As always, it's hard to believe that we're already almost halfway through AirVenture, but there's no better way than to spend hump day than in front of some of these beautiful planes. And for the next little bit, I am going to be singing music from the time period that is represented by these planes. And so we're looking at World War II towards the end of it, and then a little bit after. So hopefully you'll hear some songs that you enjoy. By all means, sing along, tap your feet, whatever it is that makes you feel happy, and get in the mood for our upcoming program. And in that vein, I'm going to start us out today with a great song called Accentuate the Positive. You've got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, latch on to the affirmative, don't mess with Mr. In-Between. You've got to spread joy, dab to the maximum, bring gloom down to the minimum, have faith, or pandemonium's liable to walk up on the scene. To illustrate that last remark, Jonah in the whale, Noah in the ark. What did they do just when everything looked so dark? Man, they said you gotta accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, latch on to the affirmative, don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between. You've got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, latch on to the affirmative, don't mess with Mr. In Between. Oh, you've got to spread joy up to the maximum, bring gloom down to the minimum, have faith or pandemonium's liable to walk up on the scene. Well, illustrate my last remark, Jonah in the whale, Noah in the ark. Yeah, what did they say just when everything looked so dark? they said you gotta accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Now, this next song is an interesting song historically because it has its roots in World War II, but did not get real fame until the 1950s. Originally, it was recorded by the Glenn Miller Orchestra, and then several other groups did it as a four voice recording. But then a wonderful singer named Etta James recorded it and turned it into one of what I call the most romantic love songs that ever exist. So if you're a guy that drug your wife here against her will, this is your chance to gain some brownie points, hold her hand, give her a nice little smooch while we got this going on. This is a beautiful song called At Last.
At last, my love has come along. My lonely days are over. Up in clover. The night I looked at you, I found a dream to press my cheek to, a dream that I can call my own. I found a thrill to press my cheek to, a thrill that I have never known. Oh, you smile, you smile. The spell was cast. Here we are in heaven. For you are mine at
Thank you very much. That really is a lovely song. And hopefully you made, whether you're a guy or a girl, you made the best of that moment. Really quickly, I want to tell you a little bit about some of the things that make all of this happen. And one of the big ones is air-to-air TV. And they have an amazing website, airtoairtv.com, and the two is the number. And I will tell you a secret. If you go on there this week, watch some of their content, and sign up for their year service, you get, I have a code for you. It's Warbirds22, and you get a year free. And you don't just get to see this stuff. They have all kinds of programming. You'll see much of the program. It'll be up on the big screen when we're not doing this kind of thing. So, guys, if you are looking for the Christmas gift that doesn't take any more space up in your wife's house, you should tell her about this. Ladies, if you've got a birthday coming up for your husband, you can give him a gift that takes up exactly zero space. And at least you'll know what he's doing on his cell phone because he'll be watching videos from now until forever. So check out airtoairtv.com. All righty, I've got about 9 minutes to go, so I'm going to sing a couple more songs for you. This next one actually was recorded in 1951 originally from the from the Broadway show Guys and Dolls, but Frank Sinatra made it famous later on one of his albums. It's one of my favorites because the one time I heard it is the only time I ever won anything from Las Vegas, a whole $20. It's the most I've ever won, but not the most I've ever lost. This is a great song called Luck Be a Lady. Luck be a lady tonight. Luck be a lady tonight. Luck if you've ever been a lady to begin with. Come on, luck be a lady tonight. Luck let a gentleman see how nice a dame you can be. Oh, I know the way you've treated other gals you've been with. Oh, luck be a lady with me. A lady doesn't leave her escort. It isn't fair, and it's not nice. Oh, a lady doesn't wander all over the room and blow on some other guy's dice. So let's keep the party. Oh, never get out of my sight. I said, stick with me, baby. I'm the gal that you came in with. Come on, luck, be a lady. Well, now I'll tell you, that's the first time I've sung that song for anybody here at Oshkosh. So I added a lot of new things to my repertoire during COVID. I know COVID was a terrible time for everyone, including me, but the upside was I had nothing to do and nowhere to be. So I've added a lot of new music. So if you're coming every day, you're going to hear some new things, for better or worse, at some point during my show. I've got three more. Luck is a lady. I've got three more for you, and this next one is a very early Dean Martin tune, but it was actually written in 1921. This is a song called All I Do Is Dream of You. All I do is dream of you the whole night through. With the dawn, I still go on dreaming of you. You're every thought, you're everything, you're every song I ever sing. Summer, winter, autumn, and spring, and we're there more than 24.
they'd be spent in sweet content, dreaming away. When skies are gray, when skies are blue, morning, noon, and nighttime too. All I do the whole day through is dream of you. You're everything, you're every song I ever sing. Summer, winter, autumn, and spring. And were there more than 24 hours in a day? Oh, they'd be spent in sweet content, just dreaming away. When skies are gray, when skies are blue, morning, noon, and nighttime too. All I do the whole day through is dream of you. Dream of you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I surely do appreciate that. Now, because we've got planes that are post-World War II, I've had a little bit of flexibility for the music, and this is another 1951 song, believe it or not. It was the first recording of Patsy Cline, and this is a song called Walking After Midnight. Maybe. For all you country fans out there, do a little vintage country.
I go out walking after midnight, out in the starlight, just like we used to do. I'm always walking after midnight, searching for you. I walk for miles along the highway. Well, that's just my way of saying I love you. I'm always walking after midnight, searching for you. I stop to see a weeping willow crying on his pillow. Maybe he's crying for me. And as the skies turn gloomy, night winds whisper to me, I'm lonesome as I can be. I go out walking after midnight, out in the starlight, just hoping you may be somewhere a-walking after midnight, searching for me. I stop to see a weeping willow crying on his pillow. Maybe he's crying for me. And as the skies turn gloomy, night winds whisper to me, I'm lonesome as I can be. I go out walking after midnight, out in the starlight, just hoping you may be somewhere a-walking after midnight, searching for me.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. I am kind of waiting to see if I have one more for you or not. I am not. Whoops. Not even going to do that one. So listen, if you want to hear more, guess what? You have to come back at 12:30-ish. That's Oshkosh time, right? Because it says a certain time, but then there's always stuff. So I will be back here at about 12:30, 12:40, because at 1 o'clock, you'll have another chance to see some new airplanes. So I would encourage you to come back and do that. If you don't come back, if you get tied up doing something bigger, better, different, whatever, I wish you a wonderful day here at AirVenture, and safe travels home or until we meet again. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Teresa. Ladies and gentlemen, Teresa Eamon, she is a regular part of our Warbirds in Review, and a very, very nice way to start off our programs. Thank you, Teresa. You are wonderful.
Thank you.
And I'm going to move over to the side here while all this activity, as we do the set change, I guess you would say. My name is Connie Boland. I am the founder and the coordinator for Warbirds in Review, but obviously I don't do one-tenth of what all these people here who make this happen do. I'd like to give a hats off at this point to our line crew, all the guys out here on Warbird Alley and the Warbirds in Review ramp people. What a nice display, and they work really hard. They're very proud of what they do, and I'm very proud of them. So thank you to all you line guys and all the other volunteers. Herding cats, you've heard that description, but have we herded cats here today? I mean, look at this ramp. That's pretty impressive. We do have the helicopters hopefully flying over to get a shot of this that can only happen here in the Warbird area. We produce Warbirds in Review with the expertise and the talents of the Sleeping Dog Productions crew, which carries on to air-to-air TV, where you can watch these live streaming. And I think they have it set up. I have asked in years past, we need to let people know what you guys do back here. So if you look up here at the Jumbotron, this is our production room where these guys make it all happen. You know, Andy, Lance, Scott, there's Nick back there. So they're so thank you to those guys and their talents. And that production room that they have outfitted, I mean, the equipment back there is pretty amazing, but they could not do that unless they had the nice facility. And there are a couple of people sitting right here on the front row that are here every day, Ron and Diane Fagen, Fagen Fighters World War II Museum in Granite Falls. Thank you for this building. Thank you, Ron and Diane. If you ever have an opportunity to visit their museum in Granite Falls, it is unparalleled. It is absolutely amazing. Their commitment to veterans and all the things that we preserve with this program and other programs, they are committed to preserving our history and recognizing our veterans. So they really are two very special people with a great family. And their son Evan's going to be part of this program today talking about their Hellcat. Where did they put the Hellcat? All right. You look around at all these cats. There's a Hellcat in here somewhere, right? To Scott's Miracle-Gro Company, we could not do this without the support of Scott's Miracle-Gro and Jim Hagedorn. And let me see, who did I leave out today? We're obviously going to talk about the cats today, so that will be beginning here very shortly. Today's program will be moderated, hosted by Ed McElhenney, Brigadier General retired from the Kansas Air National Guard. He'll come out in just a moment and introduce you to our presenters today, but let's watch the video that Sleeping Dog has produced for us.
Thank you. In November 1910, Eugene Ely took off from a modified Navy cruiser on the Virginia coast flying a Glenn Curtiss airplane. 2 months later, Ely landed on a different ship in San Francisco Bay. Naval aviation was born. Training soon moved from Virginia to Pensacola, Florida, which is the cradle of naval aviation. Every naval and marine aviator to this day traces his or her start in flying to Pensacola. Every Navy aircraft ever flown is housed in the Naval Air Museum at NAS Pensacola. If you love airplanes, especially Navy airplanes, you will love visiting this incredible museum and its National Flight Academy for 7th to 12th graders on Fetterman Way at the museum. Navy planes dominated in the Pacific War. Fighters, the Grumman Cat series, the Wildcat, the Bearcat, the Tigercat, and the Hellcat. Hellcat pilots shot down over 5,000 Japanese airplanes in the Pacific. The late Alex Vashu, the Navy's fourth ranking ace, said that he loved his Hellcat so much that if it could cook, he'd marry it.
Grumman's claim to fame in the aerospace field is their iconic Big Cat line of Navy fighters, dating back to the F4F Wildcat in the late 1930s. The carrier-borne fighter designs that began with the Wildcat and ended with the F-14 Tomcat of Top Gun fame were chiefly fighters. Their names were taken from different feline species or during the World War II years, a derivative of the cat name with an adjective in front of it. Grumman's first fighters for the U.S. Navy were barrel-chested biplanes. Known only as the F2F and the F3F, they had no nicknames. It is striking how few different types the U.S. Navy operated during World War II, particularly from carriers, and how nearly all of them were either totally brilliant or just awful. The Grumman Aerospace Corporation, now known as Northrop Grumman, made history providing combat-proven carrier fighters to the United States Navy. Each of these incredible fighter aircraft were not only advanced for their day, but would have Grumman's unique style of being named after cats that became near synonymous with Grumman's Navy fighters.
All right, Rod, you take that seat. Stu, you can be next. Evan, and then Conrad. You got that hot seat right there, Rod. That's the hot seat. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another edition of Warbirds in Review. Appreciate y'all being here. We have a distinguished cast here of pilots and airplanes. As Connie said, yeah, we are herding cats this morning, and I have to say it's really pretty cool. Quick introductions. The first guy to my left here, Rod Lewis. Some of you may know of him, may have been to his museum, down in Texas. Another, I'll categorize you as an extreme warbird aviator, and we'll be talking to him about a couple of these airplanes. But basically, let's see, four of them are owned by Rod, and one of them is owned by the Fagans, who we have already recognized out here. There's Ron and Diane right there, and their son Evan, who is, by the way, another extreme warbird aviator. I'll say that. But alongside Rod, we've got Stew Dawson, another extreme warbird aviator, experience in all these airplanes, raced in some of, not these airplanes, but similar airplanes, as in Bearcats. And so we'll be talking to him a little bit about some of those airplanes. Evan, I already talked to you about, and then Conrad Huffstutler down there, and he's kind of an expert of the first airplane that we got here, and that's the Wildcat. So those are the folks that we've got up here. And like I said, I'm honored to be here amongst these guys. And I was just thinking about it, how much time we might have in front of us in terms of warbird time. And I'll just ask, Rod, how much warbird time you think you got? All airplanes.
All airplanes? All warbird airplanes?
All warbird airplanes.
Working on about 13,000 total time, but warbirds probably 1,000.
Thousand hours of warbird time. Stu, I don't even want to go there, okay? Stu, how much warbird time you got?
4,000 or 5,000.
Okay, so we're up to it. We'll say 6,000 hours, okay? Evan, how about?
I have about 1,000.
Okay, so 7,000, and Conrad?
And I'll come in at the bottom at 500.
Okay, 75. So what you're looking at here is about 7,500 hours of warbird time in a variety of warbirds. So, gentlemen, I say thank you for being here, and thanks. Yeah, absolutely. Spectacular. With that, I'm going to ask Rod a little bit about, hey, these are his airplanes, okay? And talk a little bit about his operation that he's got down there. And he, by the way, let's see. Rod flew in the Tigercat. Stu flew a Tigercat in here. Evan, what did you fly the Hellcat?
Yep.
He flew the Hellcat in here, and I think the Wildcat was here, wasn't it? Okay, so he does fly them, and there's a story there too. But yeah, these guys flew these airplanes in. And before we go any further, too, they will be flying acro shows with a Bearcat and with a Tigercat while we're here. And we're not sure. Hey, check your schedule. We're not exactly sure when you'll see that. But with that, Rod, I'm just going to sit down and I'm going to say, okay, tell us a little bit about your operation and how you got involved. And this guy, by the way, I think he's up to 36 airplanes. Is that right? About 36 airplanes, and this guy is a patriot. Let there be no question that he's maintaining, he's flying, he's keeping the airplanes for us, and I truly appreciate that. But go ahead, Rod. I'll turn it over to you for a minute.
Well, thank you. I started out, I guess, in 95. First, I wanted to recognize one other pilot that's out in the crowd. Gordon, where are you at?
Gordon,
there he is.
Way in the back?
He's our resident Bearcat pilot. I don't know why you're not up here, but...
Okay.
Anyway, we'll get you involved. So Gordon flew the Bearcat in, and he flies this Bearcat most of the time. I've actually got three Bearcats plus a race Bearcat.
Okay.
And Stu can talk to you a little bit about that. But I started out in, back to your original question, started out in about 1994. I was really interested in the warbirds from 86 on. Didn't have enough money to buy one, so about 94 bought my first one. It was a T-28. 95, we brought it to Oshkosh. It won best T-28 in Oshkosh in that year, and then I bought a Whirlway. So those were, I had a tail dragger and tricycle gear, and I just flew those, mainly because my dad was in the Air Force 22 years, and he flew the T-28A. I happened to buy a B model with a bigger engine. So that's kind of how I got my start, and I just loved it from then on. The next aircraft I bought wasn't until about 2005, and it was an NA-50.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, it was at Chuck Yeager's Grass Valley Airport. Went there, he helped me look at it, we checked it out. And I bought that airplane. And then I bought a Mustang, and it kind of just went on from there. Really started in about 2005.
Okay. So. And now 36 airplanes later. And growing or stabilized at this point?
Growing. Okay. Yeah, I've actually got a Hellcat. It's been 7 years in the making, and I hope it's here next year.
Okay.
It was supposed to be here this year. So thank you, Evan, for bringing yours.
We'll keep our fingers crossed. Okay. Well, what we're going to try to do in this program today is we'll start with the beginning of the cat series here. So we'll start with the Wildcat, and then we'll work our way up through the Hellcat, through the Bearcat, and the Tigercat. And so with that, I'll say, okay, this Wildcat that's here is one of yours, correct? And from an acquisition standpoint, where did it come from?
Oh, boy, you've got the history on that one. But it came from the bottom of Lake Michigan.
Okay. Conrad, so you got any details on that one?
Yeah, so,
so the Wildcat we see here is a pretty special Wildcat in that it's the only true Grumman-built Wildcat. There's probably about 13 Wildcats still out there and airworthy, 12 of which were all built by the General Motors Company. So it is a rarity, and it's here today because it was lost in Lake Michigan in 1943 and spent 50 years underwater before it was brought back up and restored to flying condition. It is also an F4F-3, so all of the General Motors aircraft were a different engine and a different arrangement. This aircraft, the wings do not fold because they hadn't invented it yet. The F4F-4, the next variant, was the first one to get the folding wings. But this is the same airplane that would have fought for the United States in the early war period. This is our first fighter that we had going into World War II. You'll recognize the airplane as well from many of the early battles, Wake Island, Guadalcanal. This is the particular type that they had to fight those battles. As the years went on, they made improvements to the airplane, and they ended up going into full production on the Hellcat, so they passed off the manufacturing over to General Motors Company, and they started building FM1s and then the more powerful FM2, which is what we normally see. But a very neat airplane. We brought it up last year. We did some talks about it, and we left it here at the EAA Museum for them to showcase throughout the year and talk more about it. And we came up here a couple weeks ago, did all the inspections, test flew it, got it back into the only airworthy F4F-3. So we'll be flying it in the show, and we'll be bringing it back to San Antonio to join the rest of the collection.
Outstanding. How about, what was the limitation? Why, okay, we had this airplane, and it fought, and it did okay, but we wanted something better. What were the limitations? Why wasn't it good enough to go fight against the Zeros, et cetera?
Well, I'll back up a little bit with Grumman. Grumman started in December of 1929, and what they started doing was building floats with this very odd retractable landing gear. And they would use those floats on a different manufacturer of airplane, but it converted the aircraft to be amphibious. So that's where they got their start, and they started doing a lot of odd jobs, building truck bodies and all sorts of things to get by. But they decided they would build their first aircraft and try to win a military contract. And that first aircraft started out as a biplane. The FF1 mm-hmm. was the first one. And they made different iterations of the airplane, the F2F, the F3F, all biplanes. And the F4F originally was going to be a biplane, but the Navy said, you know, we're done with those. We want monoplanes. That's the way of the future. So the F4F was converted over to be a monoplane. But the F4F was just the most advanced thing we had at the time. And when we first got into battle with Japan, I think we had a rude awakening in that they had a very well-performing airplane. Somehow they had come up with the Zero, and the Zero could outperform the Wildcat. But the one thing that we had was a lot of good guys that came up with tactics to combat the Zero, as well as a very strong airplane. Grumman has always been referred to as the Grumman Ironworks because they built their airplanes just extremely tough. They could come home with a lot of battle damage. They had a lot of things that the Japanese didn't didn't want to put in place, nor could they put in place for some reasons. But Grumman would put self-sealing fuel tanks, which helped protect the pilot. They put more armor plating, helped protect the pilot and get them home. Whereas the Japanese Zero was a lot more lightly built and didn't have some of these amenities. So the Wildcat was the best that we had, but it still wasn't a great comparison to the Zero that we knew nothing about going into the war, but quickly found out it was a formidable fighter.
So the Zero basically could out-turn it, could out-climb it, could probably out-dive it, and we sat there and we said, hey, we needed something better.
Yeah, they had a task at hand trying to take on a Zero. A Zero was much more maneuverable, higher power-to-weight ratio, but they found that they could, you know, there's a chink in the armor. They could shoot these things, and they would light up and go down.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to devise tactics to be able to get a shot on them.
Yep, understand. All right, from there now, and we'll stop a little bit with the Wildcat. We're still doing okay on time. Okay, so we had to do something better, and so that something better was obviously the Hellcat. We bumped it up, and we said, okay, you know, hey, is this now a formidable counterpart to the Zero? And I think that's what they came up with. So, Evan, I'll turn it over to you for a minute just to talk a little bit about the Hellcat.
Sure. Well, the Hellcat was designed, obviously, by Grumman. And what they did is they brought a bunch of Wildcat pilots in to help them figure out how to make the Wildcat better. They wanted to make an improved Wildcat, and they came up with the Hellcat. You know, flying the Wildcat, they're great airplanes, but they do have a little bit of limitation factor. They're wheel-based from center wheel to center wheel is 68 inches, so it's very narrow. And, of course, being an aircraft carrier airplane, they'd point into the wind, and you don't have much of a crosswind. But the Hellcat, they wanted a more stable airplane. The Hellcat, obviously, you can see the gear is very wide. They changed the engine. It's an R2800-10, which is 2,000 horse. It's 18-cylinder. They first flew the Hellcat in June of 1942. And it had its first kill in September of 43. And the Hellcat, you know, it's not the fastest fighter, but they designed it for a 200-hour farm boy to fly in combat.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they did. It's the easiest flying fighter that I've ever flown. You know, and it's very rugged. I know there's a story of a Hellcat landed on a carrier with over 200 bullet holes.
Wow.
Very rugged. They could be shot up, but... So the Navy awarded Grumman the contract to get the Hellcat going, and they produced an amazing amount. 12,275 were built, and kind of a crazy fact, the factory heard a rumor that they were going to start laying people off, so they really started producing. And the war production record for an airplane is on the Hellcat, and they produced one an hour at peak.
Wow.
So they were pumping those things out like crazy, and the Navy actually told them to slow down. That's a true story. But so out of those 12,275, there's about 26 airframes left, and that's from a pile of parts on a pallet to this airplane here, and there's seven that are deemed flyable. And of those seven, I would say, you know, one to three on a given day are actually flying or in an annual. But the Hellcat could take a lot of punishment. It had three 50-caliber machine guns. Each had 400 rounds, each machine gun. It could hold eight rockets or up to four bombs, depending on the armament mission, I guess. But, you know, the top speed is not flashy like the Corsair, but their carrier qualifications were really good where the Corsair was struggling. So it became the Navy's go-to fighter for a long time. And it just really took hold of being the mainstay fighter. The Hellcat shot down 5,163 airplanes, which equaled 56% of all naval kills in World War II. And it lost 270 Hellcats to combat. So at a 19-to-1 kill ratio, which was the best of World War II. And David McCampbell, it was brought up in that video, he had 34 kills, which I believe was the highest scoring Hellcat ace. And the Hellcat was the first airplane to fly with the Blue Angels, actually formed the Blue Angels with the Hellcat, and then later went right to the Bearcat. But It's a great flying airplane. Last year we had Don McPherson here, who's a Hellcat ace, and he's still with us. He's 100 years old, and got to know Don, and he talked about how rugged it was in combat and how much punishment it could take. And, you know, when you fly this airplane, it's just the gentlest airplane. It really has no bad habits as long as you're doing what you're supposed to, and it's just a great platform.
How about the acquisition of this particular airplane? Where'd this one come from?
This airplane was Yanks out in Chino, California. It was there, I think, since 1976. And I kind of pestered the owner for about 3 years trying to get him to sell it. And he finally did. And then we brought it over to Planes of Fame. And Steve Hinton Jr. took this project on. He was here last year at Warbirds Interview with us. And we flew it. About a year and a half ago for the first time. And it was a very good restoration process. The Hintons are first class. You can't beat them. And they built a great airplane, so.
Yeah, I'll say now, afterwards, y'all have a chance to walk around these airplanes, take a look at them, because the rebuild process has been just absolutely tremendous on all of these things here. And the Hellcat in particular, we did that last year. And it was spectacular. How about top speed? Compare top speed on the Wildcat versus top speed on a Hellcat.
What do you consider top speed on the Wildcat cruise?
Well, I don't know that there's a number. It actually, one of the benefits of the Wildcat is it will hit terminal velocity. You can be full throttle straight down, and it will stop going faster. So the neat thing about the Wildcat is it really doesn't have any gauge markings on the airspeed indicator. The flaps are vacuum, so if you're going too fast, they just won't come down. And I guess there would be a limitation on the gear, but it's pretty rugged itself. So I don't know that there is a speed.
Huh, okay.
And the Hellcat, I'm thinking about 210 knots cross country is, but they had a very high red line, 420 knots.
Okay.
I can't even imagine getting to that, but Hellcat's built like a tank, and it'll just keep going. But it's not the fastest fighter flying over here with my dad in the P-40. He had to give me a couple inches so I could stay caught up with him. But we were doing pretty good coming over, about 266 knots with the tailwind. So
yeah, that's not bad.
Can't complain.
That's not bad. All right, let's move on to, and arguably now we're getting into the Bearcat, Tigercat category. And I'll start now, just because I think it's a cooler airplane. Well, no, I'll stay with the Bearcat. So the expert here, and I guess over here too, is Stu up here. And he's flown these things for a long time. He's raced these things for a long time. And Rod, you said you own three normal kind of Bearcats, and then that one called Rare Bear.
Right, a dash one, and two dash twos, and then a modified Bearcat.
So. All right. And okay, Stu, I'm going to put you on the spot now. What do you think about the Bearcat? How about starting out with the strange one, with Rare Bear? What do you think about racing that thing?
That's not a Bearcat.
Okay.
It doesn't fly like a Bearcat.
Okay.
It's highly modified. It's got so much chopped off the wing. The wing folds, when you fold them, they're about that big.
Okay.
The engine's been changed. We're running a 3350 versus a 2800. Okay. And a highly modified 3350.
And how much horsepower are you getting out of that thing?
Well, it's kind of debatable. They say this, they say that, but yeah. we're turning the airplane. 2800 is all you turn at 3350. We turn at 3200, and we're pushing about 80 inches of manifold pressure out of it.
Wow.
So it's doing
it's a little good. Rocket ship.
It's a rocket ship.
Uh-huh.
We have to blow the struts all the way up to be able to land it and not get the prop.
Yeah.
So your approach to the field is your nose way up in the air, and you just hope you see runway as you come across the runway, and then
no
land
flaps.
It.
No flaps.
No flaps. No.
No flaps.
No flaps. No
flaps are weight. You throw those away.
Understand. And so, I got to ask, how successful were you in Rare Bear?
I did. We raced it, what, right? 4 years? Yeah, 3 years? Four.
Yeah. I raced from 2007 to when we quit.
Yeah. So. And I got to second.
Okay. Yeah.
The next deal was going to be nitrous oxide. And that puts it over the top. Because it ran, when it was somebody else's airplane, it ran nitrous oxide. And it was a hoss. Huh. But you got to have, your nitrous guy has to be really good. Mm-hmm. Or it's just going to go bang. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
that's the race side of it. How about the normal airplane? Again, they stepped up. They sat there and they said, okay, we've got the performance from the Wildcat. That wasn't good enough. We got the performance from the Hellcat. We want to bump it up from there. And, hey, Bearcat. And they jumped that thing up there. And primarily it was a weight thing, wasn't it? Didn't they really?
Weight and horsepower.
Okay, so talk about that. So,
the Bearcat is the most maneuverable one out here.
Maneuverable as in
maneuverable
turning?
And flight, and I mean it rolls good, it climbs good, it does everything really well. It's not a hard airplane to fly. It's you know, pretty docile if you just do it right. Mm-hmm. It's light as it can be. A Bearcat is just one of the nicest ones to fly.
Didn't it have a climb to time record for a while there?
I'm not sure about that. Gordon? Okay.
It did. Okay, that's what I thought. I thought
I think
like
it was
a, you know,
3 minutes.
3 minutes to 10,000.
Sea level to 10,000.
Yeah, that's
what
I thought.
That was the criteria that it was built under.
And that's what they were looking for. They wanted climb performance out of that thing, yeah. And they lightened it up, still had big motor.
Yeah, but they were doing that, pushing 50 inches and ADI and everything, and it would go.
Okay.
It would go.
Okay.
But it's a very well-balanced airplane. Mm-hmm.
And it came, unfortunately, a little bit after the war. It really didn't
yeah,
see much.
It didn't see a whole lot.
Which is unfortunate. But it was very popular on the air show circuit, too, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
I mean, yeah.
Blue Angels.
And did well. Yeah.
Yeah, so absolutely.
So that's the next step. And now we jump into this Tigercat thing. And I got some personal experience with a friend of mine who flew the Tigercat, and that was a couple years ago. I think it was 2 years ago when Connie Bolin flew in with Stu, as I remember. And yeah, she lit up her left or right wheel?
Left wheel.
Yeah, lit up. They had a little bit of a problem, and when a magnesium wheel hits concrete, oh, there's lots of sparks. I'm here to tell you, there's lots of sparks. The good news is, no harm done. As I remember, they jacked that thing up, took the wheel off, put another one on there, and you flew another, you know, three shows or whatever it was with it. But that was that Tigercat. There are two other Tigercats here, and I don't know who wants to start talking about the Tigercat. Rod?
Yeah, I'll say a few words about it. Yeah, I think well, that's kind of my go-to airplanes. That and the P-38
okay.
are kind of the airplanes I really love to fly. I think two engines, you know, at some point in your life, you want a second engine.
I understand.
So the thrust, the takeoff power is incredible. It's a short field if you want it.
Both 2800s, right? There are 2800s
yeah,
on the money swing.
CBs and the ones that we have. And just they're very maneuverable. They're a little heavier, of course, than the Bearcat. Mm-hmm. They're tough to fly in formation because you've got those two engines. But they're you know, it's just a very safe airplane. It's docile, stalls, you know, very gentle, just like any Grumman. So it's just an incredible airplane to fly.
Speed-wise, it's probably. Straight off the assembly line, it's probably the fastest of any of these. Could I say that?
Yeah, definitely. I, when I was racing, I raced the silver one out there. I set the track record at Reno for 3.99, and that was 50 feet off the ground in the pylons. So that was, you know, we're banking the whole time.
Wow.
So it'll go.
And what's the difference between these two airplanes here now?
Not much.
Okay.
Yeah, they're pretty much the same.
Both dash threes.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. And how about acquisition? Where did they come from?
This is the first one that I bought, and it came from the museum, and what was the name of the museum?
I'll think of it here in a minute.
Yeah, it's got a...
The other one was Lone Stars.
Yeah, Lone Stars. I actually bought it from Mike Brown. Mm-hmm. He was racing this Tigercat, the other one, and it was called Big Boss Man. And then I changed the paint job, and then I raced it after that.
The other one was from Kalamazoo.
Kalamazoo, yeah, that's okay. Right. Yeah, this blue one.
Okay. And maintenance-wise, are they pretty easy to maintain, or are you constantly trying to work on these things?
We've got some guys that really know what they're doing. Okay. So I think the maintenance is just kind of a regular maintenance schedule.
Parts?
Parts. We haven't had too difficult of a time. Okay. We can find parts for them.
Okay, and I got to ask the same thing. How about parts on the Hellcat? Difficult, easy, hard, expensive?
Depends on what you're looking for, but if anybody needs Warbird parts, we sell Warbird parts, so shoot me an email.
Okay, and how about on a Wildcat?
The Wildcat's fairly easy to work on because it's a simple airplane, but yeah, parts are getting harder to come by. You end up just pulling the original microfiche film from the Smithsonian and building what you need.
Okay, thanks. Just to let you all know, this morning was kind of a special morning. We gathered out here, I think the first brief was 5:30 or something like that, and the short story is that Breitling was involved. They wanted to get involved with Warbirds, and they did. We had them here with a breakfast. They had a B-25, they had these two Tigercats and four P-51 Mustangs, and they all pre-briefed, and they wanted to go fly and take some pictures. And so that's what they did. It lasted, about an hour or so?
Over an hour, yep.
And as I remember, I think B-25 took off first, circled left, and I think the whole crowd joined up over top of the field. We watched a nice formation takeoff, by the way. I watched the two Tiger Cats took off in formation, and that was kind of cool. And then they joined up on the B-25, and then the four Mustangs joined up. And if it works, if you all take a look at the big screen, and I'm going to take a look here, I think we can coordinate so that we can show some of the stuff that went on here this morning. Scott, back in Sleeping Dog, promised me that he'd be able to do some of this stuff. And, yeah, this is the flight this morning. You can see what – and you guys, yeah, you can stand up and take a look, too. But this is what went on this morning, and we had there you go. That's the flight that went on this morning. Some good formation flying, a lot of aluminum in the sky out there. Ray Fowler, I don't know if he's in the audience or not. He was flight lead. He was flying the first B-51. We had Paul Draper as number two. Wes Stowers, number three, and Lumpy. I think it was Lumpy who was number three, and Wes was number four. And so those were our Mustang pilots out there. And I'll open up. Stu, what do you think? Was it a good flight, bad flight? Did you have fun?
Yeah, it was good. It was okay. Good. I think they got what they wanted. It was a little cloudy, and we had to kind of hunt a little bit to make it all work. But the clouds, you know, they add something to it.
Yeah.
And once we all got settled down and everything, it worked out real well.
Yeah, total flight time was probably, about a 0.8, something like that?
Yeah. Close to an hour.
Okay,
like
close
that.
To an hour, yep. And as you can see, yeah, they had some great fun up there, good formation, and some beautiful, beautiful airplanes. Okay, so we briefly touched on the Wildcat, the Hellcat, the Bearcat. The Tigercats. We've got a couple racers here. Rod, you raced for a while. Stu raced for a while successfully. I don't think you're not racing anymore, are you?
No.
Okay.
No, we've called it quits on the racing.
How about you, Stu? Are you racing anymore?
No, I finally grew up.
Okay.
We raced 18 years out there.
18 years, okay. And you guys haven't raced yet.
No.
Okay.
I race in another class, some composite sports class.
Ah, okay.
I race a Lancer, but not the Warbird side.
Winning, losing, close?
I'm beating myself every year, so that's all I go out there for.
All right, that's good. All right, so we've briefly touched on these Grumman airplanes out here, I'm probably going to open it up to questions and see what people want to know more specifically. And again, we have some experts here. So I'll say now, if I see I see Kyle out there. There we go. We got mics out there, and I already see a question. Let's start with some questions up there.
And can I recognize a couple of what I would call extreme female pilots?
Absolutely.
And one is my girlfriend, Hannah. And she's type-rated in a couple of jets.
Anna, stand up so we can see who you are. All right, outstanding.
And she's training in the B-25 right now.
Wonderful.
And then my daughter, Jessica, who's an extreme helicopter pilot, fixed-wing pilot, and training in the Warbirds also.
So. All right, and there's one more, and I don't know if she's out here or not, but in the right seat of the B-25 this morning was somebody I think Stu knows very well.
Somebody I know pretty well.
Yeah, and April, are you out there? This is Stu's wife, April?
I think she's over there at the tent.
She's in the tent. Yeah. Okay, yeah, probably. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, she's but anyway, been flying forever.
This is, as you can tell, this is a family affair here, and it was nice to see the families involved. But okay, we've got a question. I see him right there. Go ahead, sir.
Okay, is this on? Can you hear me? Is it coming through? First thing I want to say is I'm a Navy guy, and I'm in heaven looking at all these airplanes, and I want to thank everybody who was involved in restoring them and bringing them here. Thank you, guys.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
And I'm just curious, what's VMC on this Tigercat?
Well, doesn't really have one.
Yeah, we've probably pushed it to 450.
Oh, yeah, you go 450. VMC.
VMC. VMC. VMC.
Okay. They don't really publish you a VMC. They publish you a speed that you should fly. Okay? They don't say this is going to roll on you right now. But it really depends on how much horsepower, how heavy you are as to what kind of speed you're going to have to carry. It's not a published VMC.
And for those of you who aren't pilots out there, VMC is velocity minimum controllable. That's what that stands for. Okay?
Now, if you're dragging a bunch of tanks and everything, you're going to have to up it.
Probably 170.
Oh, no, it's 120, 130, somewhere right in there, depending on how much you're dragging.
Okay. Okay.
You don't want to find it.
No.
Yeah, you don't want to find it. That's correct. All right, other questions. All right, we got one over here.
What kind of approach speeds do you see different from all four models right here? Are they all similar in approach speed for landing or slightly different?
I'd say the Wildcat's probably the slowest, and I hold about 100 mile an hour indicated throughout the short approach, and then it probably touches down around 70 or it's a 3-point attitude touchdown, so 65, 70 maybe. It's fairly slow.
And I go over the fence with the Hellcat about 85 to 80 knots.
100 knots on the Tigercat.
Bearcat about 90.
Okay. So they're all close. Yeah. They're all in the ballpark for a Navy airplane. All right. I think we get another question over here.
Hi. First of all, I'd like to second the appreciation for bringing these beautiful airplanes up here. I don't see any guns on the Bear and the Tiger. Where are the guns?
There's some guns on the Tigercat, fake, on the second Tigercat, on the silver one.
On the combat, yeah. On the combat, yeah. Model, how about the Bearcat, where would they?
Nothing on them, but the Bearcat would have had, 450 calibers?
Yeah.
Six?
Six.
I'm not sure. This airplane didn't come with guns, and we've never outfitted it with guns. So it's faster without them.
We don't tend to need them much nowadays.
How about the Hellcat? About
I don't know.
Hellcat had what? Had six 650s on it, right? Yep. Okay. That's what that had. All right. More questions. All right. There's one. I see one right there. Oh, wait a second.
Have you guys ever done a dogfight with a Corsair with the Hellcat? Or do you know of how well they perform against each other?
He probably has. I haven't.
I've never done a dogfight between the two of them. I've flown both of them, and both of them are really nice. I mean, they hang on and do, but I'm thinking the Hellcat would probably take that one because the Corsair is not as fast.
A little touch on, you know, some of the Grumman technology. The Wildcat kind of started it, and then it followed up through the models, but I mentioned the vacuum flaps. The flaps were set up in such a way that you could select flaps down during combat, and they would stay up if you were going fast, but if you started to get into a turning fight, the flaps would slowly start to come out and reduce your turning radius. So that was something that the fighter pilots didn't have to play with. They'd set it to flaps down and go fight. And if the Zero wanted to utilize that, they'd have to manually do it. The Hellcat incorporates basically the same system, but it's electric.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, we've got a youngster over here. Go ahead, sir.
Which is the nicest to fly?
What is the nicest to fly? What is the nicest to fly? Okay, we'll go down the road.
Well, I haven't flown the Hellcat yet, so I would say the Bearcat.
Okay.
Yeah.
Stu?
I got to go with the Tigercat.
Okay.
And I've only flown the Wildcat and the Hellcat. I like flying them both, but I really enjoy the Wildcat.
Okay. Conrad?
Yeah, the Wildcat. There's bliss to simplicity.
Yep.
Say, Conrad, how many cranks to get the gear up?
Yeah, the Wildcat's a little more involved. It's, like I say, more manual. The landing gear is a big hand crank on the right side, and I think it's about 29. I seem to be doing other things, so I'm not counting. Mm-hmm. But if you watch it fly, it's kind of a different takeoff. What we do may be different with others, but the faster you go, the harder it is to crank. So on takeoff, it's a pretty high pitch angle, and we're trying to keep it around 100 mile an hour indicated so that there's not too much pressure on the gear. But you crank it up, and when you do so, you've got to duck your head down, so you take a break and see what's going on outside and go back down and keep cranking. But it adds to the fun and to the history of the airplane. Those guys had to do it just off the carrier back in the war.
Wow. Wow. All right. We've got another question over here.
Could you comment on the Wildcat's paint scheme? It looks like Butch O'Hare's paint scheme.
Yeah, this airplane, it's painted
say,
up.
Say the question one more time. I think people had
the paint scheme on the
okay,
Wildcat.
The paint scheme.
The paint scheme is Butch O'Hare's livery. So this airplane obviously is not the exact airplane that he flew, but this airplane was in training here in Lake Michigan and spent a lot of time underwater, but it was rebuilt and painted to be the same scheme as Butch O'Hare. And if some of you have seen recently, Paul Allen did an expedition and actually found the USS Lexington at 11,000 feet deep in the ocean, and they got video of the actual Butch O'Hare Wildcat.
Wow. Wow. Okay, another one over there.
Just curious about the fuel burn, and you always hear about oil burn.
Fuel and oil burn. Okay, let's start with the Wildcat. Well, what are you burning? Fuel-wise, gallons per hour.
It probably does about 40 gallons an hour, maybe a little bit less.
Okay.
And then oil, it doesn't burn much. Maybe a gallon every 4 hours.
Okay. How about the Hellcat?
Hellcat, I'd say the first hour, if you're using climb power and you're going up high, is maybe 75 gallons. And after you level off, it tapers out to about 55, 57.
Okay.
For fuel, and oil's probably, you know, a gallon every 3 hours, something like that.
Okay, and how much gas you carry on the Hellcat?
87 and a half in each wing, and it's got a reserve of 75. And then, of course, if you have a drop tank set up, which I don't, so.
Okay, how about it on the Wildcat? How much gas you guys carry?
Generally, it's 126 gallons in a belly tank, and then this Wildcat has a small tank in the back, about 26 or 30 gallons or something.
Okay. How about the Bearcat? What's that carrying?
Bearcat, well, you figure 75 to 80 an hour. Now, if you pull the RPM on back, that's where you'll gain your mileage.
Okay. And how much gas does that thing hold?
This one holds should hold 213 in the front tank.
All right. And how about the Tigercats? How about fuel burn on those things?
Fuel burn, we figured about, in cruise, about 135 gallons an hour. That's pulled back. And we carry a drop 680 gallons.
Okay.
Cost a little bit of money to pull up to the.
Yeah, I was just doing the math in my head there. Yeah, 130 gallons an hour. Okay, yeah, somebody do the math out there and tell me at the price of F-gas. Wow, okay, that's impressive. All right. All right, we got two questions over here. All right, go ahead, youngster.
Did the Tigercat see any action of World War II?
Tigercat see any action during World War II?
No action. It was actually a little late to the war. I think it would have been a hell of an airplane. It was a reconnaissance airplane after the war. So it came out about 6 months after the war was over. So no action.
Yeah. Yeah. The Tigercat could carry so much armament. Yeah. I mean, it's just a brute. Mm-hmm.
And it was designed as a two-seater, correct?
Well, the first one was a single-seater.
Okay.
And then they added the back seat.
Okay.
On the twos and the threes. And then I think they even did it on the late ones. But the twos and threes and fours had all back seats.
Okay.
What about Korea? What about what?
Korea. Yeah,
Korea.
The Tiger Korea saw the action in Korea. It had different roles after the war, but question specifically World War II, it was too late for World War II.
One of the things that was real good about the Tigercat is it became a firebomber, and it was fantastic. And everybody liked it. It would carry a large load, and they could get down in the valley and then drop their load, and they could come out of there. Mm-hmm. It just got so much horsepower. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another one over here.
I got here a little late, and I haven't heard much about the P-38. The reason is I'm a Gold Star son, and my father was killed over France on a P-38. And we found the crash site, and he said it was the best fight. He thought it was better than the P-51.
Okay. Yeah, the P-38 we're not going to be talking about today, I don't think.
Well, I wasn't here yesterday.
Okay, sorry about that. But as long as we're talking about that, and thank you for your father's sacrifice, I'll say that.
Absolutely.
But what I would like to do, and I always do this in my presentations, I'd like those who are serving on currently active duty or in the reserves or veterans, I'd like you all please to stand up. We'd like to give you a hand. So active duty, veterans, reserve. Thank you for your service. All right, we got another question down up front.
I just had a Wildcat question. Can you compare the Wright-powered versus the Pratt-powered?
Yeah, so I've actually had the opportunity. I rebuilt an FM2 in 2013, which Evan now owns. And I guess, one of the few to fly both of them recently. But the FM2 had the 1820 Wright engine, which was 1,350 horsepower. And it was supposed to be what they called the Wilder Cat. It added power, and they pulled out a little weight, what they could. So the FM2 is a great performer, but I would say the Wright 1820 is a little bit more rough engine. It beats you around a bit more. This particular Wildcat, the F4F-3, has an 1830 Pratt & Whitney, which is a twin-row 14-cylinder. So right off the bat, it's a lot more smooth and just a more enjoyable to fly.
A DC-3 motor.
Yeah, so this particular airplane has a DC-3 motor, a Dash 94, which is more horsepower than what it would have had in the war. So this particular Wildcat has equal horsepower to the FM2, but it doesn't have the folding wing, and it doesn't have all the guns. It's got four guns rather than six, and it has been lightened up, armor plating and whatnot. So anyway, this one is a particularly good performer versus the FM2. So I got to say, I do enjoy this one a little bit more, but they both have their advantages.
Thank you. All right. We got one. Go ahead, up top there.
I understand that the Bearcat has a little bit of an unusual wing structure, spar structure, compared to other planes. Could you explain that?
Spar structure on the Bearcat.
Stuart, you want to take that one?
I have not rebuilt one of those, so I can't really comment on the wing as far as the structure and what's in there. I'm not familiar with that.
I can give you a little bit.
All right, there we go. I was going to say, we got another Bearcat guy over here, too. He might know. I'm not sure. But go ahead, Conrad.
I don't know what you're referring to exactly, but the Bearcat originally was designed with kind of a special feature where the wingtips would come off. If you over-G'd the airplane, the wingtips would come off and reduce the load on the spar. So that was an attempt to make the airplane lighter by underbuilding the spar, but still not having any aerodynamic failures.
The bad thing about that, if one came off.
Yeah. So one would come off and put you into a fun situation. So they ended up just kind of going away from it. And what we deal with nowadays is a little bit of an underbuilt spar. And I don't know the particulars about the spar, and I've not rebuilt one, like he said. But this one, you can see, has a spar strap. There's a cap that's been added to give a little extra strength. And then some of the newer Bearcats that are being rebuilt are being built with a heavier spar, a different material, and a better spar.
Yeah. There's another way to do that. Cut the wings off like bear and don't worry about it.
What was top speed? What'd you get out of Rare Bear? I'm just curious.
Last time it was 490 something.
Okay.
Qualifying. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. All right. Up top.
Is it possible to visit your museum in San Antonio?
Yeah, it is. Most of my airplanes, I've got a ranch just west of San Antonio, and that's where most of the aircraft are right now. But there's probably half of them at each location. And, yeah, the one in San Antonio, sure.
Okay. All right. Sounds like he's going to visit. All right. We got another one up top here.
Yes, you don't read too much about the Tigercat going aboard the ship. Do you? Can you address that at all? Or were there any squadrons that deployed the Tigercat on the ship?
You know, they were made to land on the ship. Yeah. I can't tell you whether they ever landed any on the ship.
Yes, they did.
They did, okay.
They were aboard the boat. But it wasn't, the airplane was made for that, but it wasn't used primarily for that because it worked good off the land, too. And it has good range. We can put 300-gallon drops, one in the middle, and then got some on the outboard. So it'll go a long ways.
And one of the characteristics about landing this airplane is it is made to land on the carrier, so the struts are really stiff. If you don't slam it on, it's gonna come off sideways, and it's hell, you know, when you're taxiing, it's hell to taxi off the runway if you're going the wrong way. So we try to land firmly when we land one of these, unlike the others where we want to grease them on.
Okay. All right, one more.
Were these planes equipped with tail hooks, or how do they land on carriers?
They had tail hooks.
Okay. And yeah. As far as catapults, that came after their
they
use?
Didn't need it.
Yeah. None of these airplanes took off with catapults, but they all landed with a tail hook. And,
yeah, you put your flaps down and get one of these off in 1,000 feet.
Yeah.
If you start inspecting them afterwards, you'll start to find little hooks up in the wheel well areas. The Wildcat's got a little hook in the center. In between the landing gear, the Hellcat.
Yeah, you can see them right behind the.
Yeah, they're there. So they did have some board. Hooks for a bridle and a catapult system later. And then one of the Grumman benefits was the tail hook was not truly exposed. It would suck up into the back of the tail or be fared into the tail, so it wasn't hanging out like you normally see, but they are tucked up in there somewhere.
It's tucked up in there on the F7. It's just about, you can't see it.
And I will say there's going to be a cat flight. Do we know when? I don't think we do yet, where they're going to have the Hellcat, the Wildcat.
It's this afternoon, and I'm not sure. I've got a briefing at 11 o'clock. Oh, now.
Yeah, yeah. But there's two guys that need to leave now. But yeah, there is going to be a cat flight where we're going to have the Tigercats, the Hellcats, the Wildcats, and the Bearcats, I think, all flying together. So that'll be a celebration of the cats. And, yeah, this afternoon, it sounds like, is when we're going to be doing it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right. One last question anywhere? Nope. All right. With that, I'll say, first of all, Rod, Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ed. Appreciate it.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for being the caretaker of these airplanes.
And, appreciate it.
And Stu, same thing. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Keep
thank
flying
you.
Safe out there, Evan.
Thank you.
Conrad, thank you. You bet. Thank you, folks, for coming. This afternoon, we got two ME-109s that are going to be parked out here, and it should be a good show. So thank you all for being here.
For grass, made to feel the joy of each and every blade, between our toes, across our backs, to run over its hills, marvel at its beauty, and find comfort in its stillness. We were made for grass. It's where we battled and celebrated, built monuments, grew families, forged memories, and pushed ourselves farther than ever before. We were made for grass. To care for, nurture, and cultivate. We've always made sure to have a patch of our own, because there's no greater feeling than being on the grass. Except leaving it.
joined this organization, and it's a constant learning process. And that's another thing that I love about it, because a good pilot is always learning, always.
NETA membership isn't just for pilots. It's for everyone who loves aviation, past, present, and future.
We have a lot of members that are not, they're not even pilots. They love the fact that the airplanes still fly, and they share the enthusiasm and the pride that's going on.
It's a place where history comes to life, where the future is sparked by imagination, and where aviation is more than just wings in the air.
That's what it's all about at the end of the day. What else is it for?
I was asked, you know, where do I see NATA going into the future? And I see nowhere but up.
Be a part of it. Join NATA today.
all by itself. It just, it does it itself. Okay?
Yeah, you're right there with me, though.
Every time I open the hangar door to go flying, I realize that I'm one of the lucky guys doing something that I dreamt of as a kid.
World War II changed the world forever, and forever after. Fagen Fighters World War II Museum of Granite Falls, Minnesota was created as a tribute to the men and women of the greatest generation whose incredible sacrifices during World War II won and preserved the freedoms we enjoy today. The Fagen Fighters World War II Museum is the dream, the creation, and the passion of the Fagen family of Granite Falls, Minnesota. Ron and Diane Fagen and their sons, Aaron and Evan.
We've taken on a mission to connect the latest generation with the greatest generation because these are events in our history that need to be remembered. And in our case, and in the case of young children, they need to be introduced to. And we feel they're very important and need to be preserved, and that's what we're trying to do.
The mission is to preserve the memory of the heroes of World War II, promote patriotism in today's Americans, and inspire tomorrow's leaders to study and apply history's lessons. It's not enough that these beautiful airplanes are collected and restored. The Fagen Museum restores each of them to flying condition.
I think with everything at the museum, having stuff operational is important because people get to see them, how they were used, and get to hear them start up, and it gives people a better perspective of what these machines were capable of and what they look like in here.
There are no markers, monuments, or visitor centers in the skies above Europe, the Pacific, or the China, Burma, India theaters of World War II. These airplanes are the monuments. They are timeless portals to the courage and deeds of those who gave their all to preserve all that we hold dear. When the museum's airplanes are not flying, they are displayed in three hangars: the trainer hangar, the fighter hangar, and the bomber hangar.
World War II was a worldwide conflict, and unfortunately it's not being taught in our schools anymore. But history always has a tendency to repeat itself, so we got to educate the younger generations about World War II. So learn these experiences from the past so you can apply them in the future to help guide this country in the right direction.
I know the buildings are built to last 250 years. The stories that are contained within these buildings will last just as long. We're connecting some of the battles. The only thing we can connect them with are the ground machines, which many people have a connection to rather than the aircraft.
With the museum opening, I started looking into the military vehicles. Started with the deuce and a half. The ambulance, that, when I had that repainted, we made sure that it matched the 4th Medical Battalion. And the 4th Medical Battalion actually were the first ambulances to arrive on D-Day. The ground vehicles all operate. Fully functional, and we could start them all up and take off and drive them right now.
The Fagen Fighters World War II Museum doesn't just tell the story of what happened. It is dedicated to preserving the stories of those who lived it, telling us how it happened. Veterans and others are invited to the museum to share their stories firsthand. Their stories are recorded and preserved through the museum's Voices of Valor program.
Let's do our museum around my father, Ray Fagen, and his World War II experiences. The first campaign medal he got was Normandy invasion. Second campaign medal he got was liberation of Paris. And the third campaign medal he got was the Battle of the Bulge. Says you never can't imagine how terrible it was.
We decided to make our collection a real museum when people referred to it as such. We opened the museum doors directly after our air show in 2012, so the date was June 17th, 2012.
The Fagen Fighters World War II Museum puts its collection in context for visitors by using original murals, sculptures, paintings, photographic collections, and other fine art to tell the story of epic events such as D-Day, June 6, 1944. This rail car, which anchors the museum's Holocaust exhibit, was found after years of searching in Germany and brought here so that no generation will ever forget the horror of the Holocaust or the memories of those who were lost.
When the Germans marched in, I was 7 years old. When I was liberated in January 18, 1945, I was 8 years old. And these are some of the things I remember.
The best single teacher we have about the lessons of the Holocaust are survivors. And for years, they've been the most important teachers. Sadly, as historian Deborah Lipstadt would say, the tyranny of biology means we have fewer and fewer survivors to speak. Memorials, and that's almost too static a term, opportunities to learn, like this exhibit, which opens people's eyes to the horrors of the Holocaust, are becoming ever more important in the absence of survivors. So what the Fagens have done here with their exhibit is to create a wonderful, remarkable learning opportunity for people of southwestern Minnesota, entire state, upper Midwest, and I know people from coming from all over the world and learning about the Holocaust through this specific lens. So we thank the Fagens for their generosity of spirit, their vision, and their commitment to Holocaust education as they teach about the Second World War.
We're very happy to call the JCRC friends. They have visited the museum a number of times. We're very helpful in our Holocaust exhibit when we were building that at Split Rock Studios. And we are thrilled to be the recipient of their yearly award.
Someday, sooner than we'd like, the headline will read, Last World War II Veteran Dies. When that day comes, how will we connect the greatest generation with the latest generation? Restoring these things to their original power and function, and capturing the stories of those members of the greatest generation who are still with us, offers not only a portal to the past, but an immortal connection to America's future generations.
Repeating that you'll never fall in love, but and everybody keeps retreating, but you can't seem to get enough. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door to your heart. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door. Let my love open the door to your heart.